Dear students, welcome again to Knowledge Area 2. My name is Lucas Kabobe. I'm continuing with this discussion on OIR 101, an introduction to the study of colleges. As you remember, we have finished Knowledge Area 1, and then on Knowledge Area 2, we shall discuss nothing but very political thoughts and values. In the political science, we are being guided in different issues. The first thing that in the political science and politics, we have our framework. Our framework is guided by many things. In the knowledge area, one we saw something about the theories, but now we need to discuss together the political thinking of different political thinkers, their views on how they viewed different political phenomena. In this regard, when we discuss knowledge area 2, I have tried to highlight and analyze some of the political thinkers, great and giant political thinkers, that I think you know the area. So shall we pass from the one and see their ideas, ideas, and try actually not only see the ideas that they have there. The relevant question will be, what is the contribution of these political ideas to the contemporary Tanzania, contemporary Africa, and the contemporary world at large? So as we are trying to pass through these ideas, you must have a base, you must always ask yourself this question. For example, I'm reading Socrates. Socrates was saying one book to the people. Now, what is the importance of this political thinking in the contemporary world? This is very important. That's why we are trying to learn about the political thought and the values of different scholars. As you can see on the board, I have tried to collect for a few, because there are so many, tried to for a few of the political thinkers that I am sure every student will be at the position of reading and understanding first, as we discussed together in class here, but secondly, at your ample time to understand and read more on Socrates, and read more on Plato, read more on Aristotle, read more on Thomas Hobbes, read more on Jack Rousseau, read more on John Locke, read more on Baron de Montesquieu. So these are some of the political thinkers which I think we as students must be able to read and learn and understand, get the ideas and see how they contribute to the development of Africa, Tanzania and the world at large. To begin with, I need you students to understand what is political philosophy. Political philosophy, in a very nutshell, this is a study of social organizations and the relationship between the individual and the society. In political philosophy, we are trying to see one thing. How does an individual relate to the society? Remember, at first, in knowledge area 1, we had the concept that a human being is the political animal. We have the concept that a human being is the social being. And a human being and social being keeps on changing now and then due to different circumstances. Now, political philosophy is trying to describe a person in relation to the environment, in relation to his culture, in relation to his society. This is what we call political philosophy. And a political philosopher actually may have some questions in mind in this kind of thinking. What is the real form of government? When I speak of a real form of government, what is the best form of government that we need to aim as individuals? What is the best form of government that we need to have as individuals? What are the root causes of certain problems? It is evident that our societies have different problems. The question becomes, what is the cause of these problems? As we are trying to associate and they read to grasp what is the relationship between a man and a society. What are the basic causes of the problems that we have? If we have freedom, we satisfy. What is freedom? Do we need freedom? Is there any purpose of having freedom? This is what is questions. What is liberty? Do we need to have liberty? Do we need to have justice in the society? What gives any government the right to rule? We have a government, yes. Does it have a right to rule? How is the government formed? We shall come to discuss this very, very question when we are reading something about the social contract theory. It will show us how the state was formed and who is the proponent of formation of the state according to social contract theory. Another question that we need to ask ourselves as students: what are the characteristics of a good or just a society? To call a society is not enough. Is it a good society? Is it a just society? So we must be able to analyze, among other issues, these questions. So these questions actually are leading us, are guiding us on how we must be able to interpret the political thinking of different political mission scholars as I try to identify them on slide number one. All these actually are the roots in Greece, ancient Greece, where we can see the scholars. For example, the book of Philosophy can be traced back in 2 millennia ancient Greece, far back the political philosophy. The word philosophy comes from the Greek word philosophia, which means love of wisdom. Philosophia means love of wisdom. And the word political comes from the Greek word politikos, which means of or pertaining of the polis. Very important sometimes to understand. As you can view, this is the school of Athens, where actually this town of Athens has produced very important political thinkers, as you shall be able to discuss in this knowledge area too. Here is Thomas Hobbes, our first political scholar. Who is Thomas Hobbes? When we read about Thomas Hobbes, the issue that as a student of political science, you must never forget. Try to understand his political thinking. Very important, understand the thinking of Thomas Hobbes first. Try to understand what influenced Thomas Hobbes to have such a kind of thinking. Let me take you back. I have told you, in this political philosophy, we are reading a man and how he or she is associated with his environment and society. We are as we are due to the surrounding around us, the environment we have, and the society we are being reared. So you can see Thomas Hobbes, how was he influenced by different environment that he has passed through? So, Thomas Hobbes is considered the founder of modern political philosophy. He lived in and formulated many of his philosophical views during the English Civil War. Thomas Hobbes explains his view of human nature in his book, The Grammar. So for him, we're trying to see, he is trying to describe the human nature. How does the human nature look like for him? The first point he tries to express, he says human nature or human beings are self-interested. They are selfish. First me and the rest. Of course, they say child begins at home. You cannot give what you don't have. According to Thomas Hobbes, human beings are self-interested. So whatever they do in a society, whatever they think, is because of the self-interest. In the other way around, it is like this. I am doing 1, 2, 3. How shall I benefit? That is the prescribing the human vessel. According to Thomas Hobbes, his first assumption on human nature is that the human beings are selfish. Whatever the case you are doing, a human being is selfish. And then again, another important aspect is that to describe, a human being is rational. Difference between the rational and the irrational. That's why we say rational human beings. When you are described as irrational, this is an insult. It is not a virtue, it's a vice. We are expecting animals to be irrational. But a human person is rational. What do I mean by saying a human person is rational? When you are rational, you can be able to think properly and make a sound decision. You can be able to reason. This is bad, this is good as a human person. So according to myself, first, human person is self-interested and an egoistic perspective. But in the second point about him, the nature of human person says a human being is rational. Our ability to reason is an instrument of our self-interest. It allows us to figure out the best way to get what we want. But a human being must be able to reason. Can you be able to reason? Why am I here? Why am I listening to this lecture? Why did I decide to pursue my studies? Why did I marry? Why do I need to marry? Why do I need to get married? Why? You are trying to reason. Tomorrow I need travel maybe to Maine. Why should I go to Maine and not to Vancouver? Why? What is that? So a human person must be able to reason, according to Thomas Hobbes. We are trying to see, understand a human person, and then later, when you start to see the environment around, we shall be able to see what has motivated such kind of thinking. Thomas Hobbes is the first critical thinker to fully explore the social contract theory. The social contract theory. So something very important to understand about Thomas Hobbes is about the social contract theory. It is from the social contract theory that you can see. Actually, this theory, my dear students, get very much keen on this. Thomas Hobbes is the father of the social contract theory. It is through the social contract theory that it explains the formation of the state. Changes from the state of nature to social contract theory. To develop this theory, Thomas Hobbes begins by describing life before government, a certain time or place which we call the state of nature. In the state of nature, there was no government, there was no law. Everybody was judged of himself. He was judged in the positive term of everybody. For example, I'll give you another example. In the state of nature, there were no courts, there was no government, there was nothing. Everybody has power. I have power. Today I have power, yes, but I have surrendered my power to the body of the government. If it happens that you come to me and they slap me, I cannot revenge. Law does not allow. What do I do? I'll take you to the police, I'll take you to the courts, so that you'll be judged. But before Thomas Hobbes came up with this theory, the state of nature in a current honest state way, if someone can say, you do me, I do you. If this can be allowed to be said. You come and the state of nature, man is rational, man can reason. The state of nature, since man is self-interested, and since resources are limited, life in the state of nature will be very brutal. It will be very difficult because everybody is the judge, everybody is the police, everybody is the prosecutor. It is impossible. Everyone believes in a constant fear because they cannot trust one another and the future can never be certain. Since man is rational and since life in this environment is so brutal, it follows that a rational person should try to leave the state of nature as soon as possible. Now, Thomas Sowell is trying to show the repercussion which may be a couple, which a man may face if he or she intends to leave the state of nature. Where there is no rule, where there is no regulation, where there is no police, everybody is the judge of everything. To escape the state of nature, people entered into a social contract theory. Now, we are now coming up from the state of nature to have a social contract theory. People have power, but now they surrender their power to one body. And that body is what we call the government. And that government, as I said before, we have three basic issues: to protect the life of the people, to protect the right of liberty and property. Very important, we need to understand. When the changes are from the state of nature to social contract theory, we are forming a government. I have power. I surrender my power to a certain body. That body is government. But the best function of the government will be free. The first, that government formed out of social contract, the government must be able to defend and maintain people's lives. Second, to maintain people's property. The third thing, to maintain people's liberty. That is how the state was formed according to Thomas Hobbes. So they agreed to give some of their rights, to assume some responsibilities in exchange for lowering the world, as I was saying. Once people enter into the contract, they needed someone to enforce that contract. For Hobbes, a strong monarch with doubts of power was necessary to enforce the contract in the keep order. So, there is this kind of presentation that you must be able to see. Since the state of nature was state of war, one must seek the state of peace. State of nature is the state of war, as I told you. You steal my chicken, I become the king, and they come and they kill you. Nobody's going to accuse me because you don't have any over. That is trying to supervise us. So the state of nature is an development with no law. The state of peace must be one where it is law. If an environment is ruled by law, it is a place where people do not have right for things. In order to get out of the state of nature, people have to give up some of their rights and they pursue certain responsibilities. Very important. Thomas Hobbes is trying to explain the state of nature. Now, for social contract. This is actually a contract for promoting a social contract theory. So, when we speak of the social contract theory, we speak of Thomas Hobbes, who has his ambitions and assumptions. But basically, he comes up with the formation of the state through the social contract theory. Very important to understand. Another scholar that this time I think in Nigeria too, when we start together, is about John Locke. This is an English physician and philosopher. He combined his medical observation and his experience to develop ideas about human nature and the government. John Locke explained his ideas in his most famous work, Two Treatises of Civil Government. Like Thomas Hobbes, John Locke begins his explanation by examining life in the state of nature. So he's also making some analysis on how the state of nature was and how things must go. According to John Locke, rights, God gave man rights to life, liberty, and property. These are basic natural rights, according to John Locke. His idea is being shared by Thomas Hobbes. Sometimes you may be asked a question. I'm thinking of is the thinking made of John Locke and Thomas Hobbes alike? Where do they give from? Where, on which ideas do they share similar? A similar idea is this about the rights to liberty, property, and life. Very important, these very important ideas. So that the earth used the determine the reason. So for him, he had three issues that he's speaking about. First, the natural rights, rights to life, liberty, and property. Second, they have the right, they have God gave man earth, live on it, they preserve it. But third one, the ability reason. Look at this interesting philosophy, you know, the ability reason. In order to defend their life, health, and liberty, possessions, people enter into a social contract, forming governments that exist. But then individual rights to help solve the conflict between the citizens. So why, according to general, why should we form government? We are forming government because we need to preserve our rights, our individual rights, we need to preserve our property, and then our life, but more so in a community, because I've told you, a society has conflicts, a society has conflicts and a problem. So the state that has been formed by the government must be able to solve these problems. This is according to general. For general, all other contracts, free speech, free press, freedom of religion, depends on government that guarantees secure property rights. So this will be the result of the basic three rights. When you are for the government, that is for protecting your rights, your life, your liberty, and your property. Eventually, freedom of press, the religion, freedom of speech will come automatically. This is according to John Locke. The question comes again, because I've told you, when we're making a discussion of these scholars, you must be able to see, are these ideas practical today? If yes, to which extent are they being practiced? If no, what are the challenges that are embarking on practicing these very important issues in political science? If a government fails in its duties to protect the natural rights of life, liberty, and property, John Locke believes the people have the right to control it. According to John Locke, now is becoming as a regionalist now. If we make a social contract, the government fails to protect our life and liberty or the property and the life, according to John Locke, if we suppose he suggests for people to overthrow the successful government because it has failed completely to maintain free rights of the people. In this way, the power of the government does not come from the consent of the government. And now, members, I now understand that you know what it means by the social contract theory, the how the state and the government have been formed is the result of the social contract. Another scholar that I think we will discuss together is Charles Montesquieu. This also was a French philosopher. on the script of course, this is a book. If we compare different European governments and they argue with that, look at this argument. The best government are the expression of power. Different powers are divided equally among separate branches. Each branch should have the ability to check the powers of the other two. In this way, the person or group will become the path. Montesquieu's theories are the profound impact on the framers of the US Constitution. What is so remarkable about that from this part of the Montesquieu is the father of the separation of power. When I speak of the separation of power, I think you understand. We speak of three organs of the government. So of the state. We have the government, so we have the executive, we have the judiciary, and we have the legislature. Three pillars of the government. The executive, the judiciary, and the legislature. These are three pillars of the government, and actually they must check and balance each other. The Montesquieu very important to notice, this is the father of special power. Trying to explain what the executive must be doing, the do's and don'ts of the executive to other branches, the do's and don'ts of legislature to other branches, the do's and don'ts of the judiciary to other branches. So very important to mark that just democracy is the father of expression in your power. There is a difference between the expression of power and the fusion of power. In the future discussion, we shall be able to see and understand the difference of these two things. Another very important scholar is Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Rousseau was a philosopher, novelist, and composer. Rousseau argued that man by nature is basically good. For Rousseau, men are corrupted by the evils of society, including art, science, and technology. Look here, as I told you, here we are trying to bring man and his environment of his society. For him, man is naturally good, is not never bad. What brings bad things to a man is because of the environment, is because of society and technology. That this can change that goodness of man to become bad. The social contract also represents the vision of good government. According to Jean-Jacques, what is the good government according to you? Good government has the consensus of the people and they get the will. So any government that can be consistent must be a result of the people, according to you. So citizens are part of the whole, the common good must be placed above self-interest. He's totally against self-interest. For him, the government must be a result of the will of the people. The same thing we have seen in the other scholars about the social contract. People must be able to form their government, and the government must be there to work to the people in the not and the not otherwise. So I think having seen the discussion of this week, three, four scholars, you need to take time and read extensively. This is like an assignment. Read extensively on Socrates, the philosopher, great philosopher. Of course, Socrates. And then there is something about Plato, maybe something about Aristotle. Remember, Socrates is the teacher of Plato, and Plato is the teacher of Aristotle. So these fathers of political thinking, it's very important for you to read and understand these philosophers, get their ideas, and see what is the contribution of their ideas to the current political development. However, try at the best to get some questions as I post in the book. We get the knowledge area discussion question, we get the assignment question, read, try to attempt, and the test yourself quite well. I think after discussing this, you'll be able to know and analyze the political thinking of Plato, the political thinking of Thomas Hobbes, and the political thinking of Aristotle, Socrates, and the rest. With this note, dear students, I hope we shall be at a good position of ending knowledge area 2. Thank you for your kindness and your good attention. I welcome you again as my third global father in discussion of political science in knowledge area 3. Thank you for your support. You are listening.